would say make opportunities for yourself. It's really easy to wait for the phone to call, but you don't get a lot of gigs that way to begin with, right?
Sure.
So making opportunities for your friends, even if it's just to play a free concert out in the park on a nice weather day, right? Mm-hmm. Or to call up a church and say, hey, I have some players that we'd love to play for one of your services. I'm Tim Albright, and I teach trombone, and I also coach one of the jazz combos here. I guess I started my freelancing career while I was at college. So I went to the Eastman School of Music and got my undergrad there. And while I was there, I did the odd gigs here and there. I did a lot of big band gigs and weddings and some brass quintet, like church gigs, like that. And my senior year while I was there, I got hooked up with a guy named Steve Coleman through Ralph Alessi, who was one of my jazz teachers there, amazing jazz trumpet player. He was playing with Steve Coleman, and Steve was a big deal at Eastman. He's a big deal now, gotcha. But we all studied his music a ton. And what I didn't know is that Ralph had recommended me and a couple of other players to play on this album of Steve's in New York City. And I got a call from Steve out of the blue saying, hey, can you come play this record in New York? And I thought it was one of my friends playing a prank on me. So I said, yeah, what are you talking about? And I said, no, it's Steve Coleman. And so in any case, that's kind of where my gigging career started, was getting to play with him, doing a few records, and traveling the world playing in his band.
Wow.
over the span of a few years. Out of school, I moved to New York after about a year of moving back with my parents in California, kind of saving up money, playing gigs. I did a cruise ship for a few weeks.
I've heard that's a good gig.
It was cool. It was cool. I was glad to have done it for a short time.
Sure.
Yeah, it was fun. It was a nice way to make a little bit of savings.
Yeah.
In addition to play with Steve. Then I moved to New York and started freelancing. I moved in with some college friends and paid a little bit of rent and ate a lot of ramen and pizza for dinner and kind of took every gig that came my way. In my fourth month I was there, I got offered a gig to go on the road with a Broadway touring production. So imagine when like Hamilton or the shows come through Appleton, that was what I did. We played a lot of big cities, Chicago and LA and Seattle, and at the end of the tour, we even went to Japan.
Wow.
It took me a long time to decide whether or not I was going to take that gig in the first place, because I was just kind of getting my sea legs in New York.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought, well, this will be another chance to get to play and also to kind of build that nest egg for when I came back to New York City.
Sure.
And be able to not worry so much about having a day job. In fact, having that gig allowed me to come back to New York and not have to work at a cafe or whatever, selling insurance or something, which there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, but it made me more available, right, when I came back.
Sure.
And I wasn't worrying so much about making ends meet right away. And I did that for, when I moved back to New York City after taking that tour, I was there for about 15 years playing a lot of Broadway shows, but also playing in a lot of orchestras and jazz groups and a lot of recordings and chamber music. And
right.
Been making a whole hodgepodge of a gig and a lot of teaching as well. Right, well, it didn't open up overnight, right?
Right,
it took a long time. Growing my reputation, I suppose people knew me as a good player, but also someone that was nice to hang around with.
Sure.
As well, and who would also show up, right?
On time.
Show up on time, right? And kind of know my music. I pride myself in trying to be the most prepared person that walks in the door in a rehearsal, because I never want to be that person that's not ready to do something, right? So going into any gig, I just worked my butt off to know what it was going to be like before I walked in there. If I didn't have to sight read, I would be cool, right? But I also got to be a good sight reader as well. So just kind of putting myself out there and being dependable.
Gotcha. Yeah, like setting good impressions.
Totally. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But at the time, you're just doing it, right?
Yeah, you're just doing the work.
You're doing the thing and enjoying doing it. To be honest, I can't remember my very first gig where I got paid money. Sure. Maybe I'll tell you one where I screwed up, because that would probably be helpful to folks.
Yeah.
This is actually not in your... It was when I was still at Eastman. And I was working with a group, a guy by the name of Gap Mangione. He's actually Chuck Mangione's brother.
Mm.
And he was a keyboard player, and he had a big band that would play weddings and different functions. I was one of the subs for this band. It was really fun and a way to make a little bit of money. I hadn't learned how to create a good schedule yet, because I didn't have to, right? I didn't have very many gigs, and all of my classes at Eastman were all at the same time, right? So I had no reason to have a schedule, because I just knew when everything was going to be, including like performances, like, okay, we have to play with the big band. Okay, it's this night, I'll show up. Well, I double booked myself for this professional gig, and I didn't realize that I had done it until 2 weeks out. And so I called up Gap and said, hey, I'm really sorry, but I can't go to this gig. And he read me the riot act.
Oh, no.
For a number of reasons. I mean, because it was so late, but also because I was just saying, hey, I'm really sorry, I can't make it to this gig. Okay, take care.
just casual.
Yeah, exactly, right? What I've realized since then is the way that happens. I mean, things, you know, you make mistakes, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what I should have done was found myself a sub and said, I'm really, really sorry, Mr. Mangione, I can't make it to this gig, but I have so-and-so lined up who's going to do like a way better job than I could have ever done. If you would like, I can talk to him or her and have them come and sub for me on this. And it still would have been uncomfortable, but that would have been way better. And then I also learned that I needed to keep a schedule and be able to, you know, to know when everything is happening so I don't double book myself. And I had my schedule backed up, you know, a week, 2 weeks in advance. I knew what I was needing to prepare for. So say I was subbing on a new Broadway show, for example, I would be shedding that show, and I had a timeline for when I needed to have it done. And I would make sure, at the end of my time in New York, I think I had a rule that I had to play through the show three times, like practice it all the way from the beginning to the end three times. Before I went in and played it. So I just kind of mapped that out. So I knew, again, so I had, you know, could go to the gig without a shadow of a doubt that I'll be able to nail it. At the same time, I always tell people when I was in New York, and really all the time, like even when you're in school now, like every day is an audition in some way or another, right? People are listening to you and also watching you to see how you act in a situation. That can be really nerve-wracking too, right? To think, oh no, I have to be cool. I have to always be on. So I had to learn how to also balance that with remembering to enjoy playing the trombone.
Sure.
So that's at the end of the day, that's the most important thing. One of them, I'm hesitant to even tell you because it's really embarrassing. I mean, I mentioned how careful I am about making sure I'm prepared for things and making sure that I have everything I need. Recently, while I've been at Lawrence, this wasn't like gig per se. It was a rehearsal with some buddy as I was getting a trombone quartet together, and we were rehearsing in Chicago. I didn't bring my trombone to this quartet rehearsal. I have no idea how that happened. So I quickly called my buddies from the road and said, hey, I forgot my trombone, and do you happen to have one that I could borrow? And the second person that I called did. So that's one story. I learned my lesson again on that one. It totally depends, but this is my new bag. So if I were going to like the first rehearsal of a show that I was starting, I would have a mute bag with all of these mutes doubled, because I would also need it for my bass trombone. So I'd have all the bass trombone mutes. I would have two music stands. And then this is just my tenor, like my large bore tenor horn.
Sure.
And I've got two mouthpieces in case I need to shift things up, but also, you know, to give someone a mouthpiece that they forgot theirs,
right.
which happens.
Yeah.
And then I've got just all my my lube, stuff to kind of just keep my trombone in working order. And then my phone, right? Because on my phone is my Google Maps, but it's also my metronome and my tuner, and also like all the music that I need to be learning. I do a lot of listening on the way to gigs. So I think that's it. I don't know. I'm trying to think of other things that I need to bring to a gig. Yeah, it's that checklist. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you should have seen me sometimes traveling around, you like walking around New York City with two gig bags and like two mute bags, and yeah, it was a little crazy. Yeah,
and the bass and the trombone.
Exactly. Yeah. Wow. Let's see, the three or four things that go into making like a successful musician or freelancer. Of course, there are so many different paths, but number one is, can you play? Right, and that's super important. Can you get along with other people? Your like interpersonal skills. Do you actually show up? Like your own self-organizational skills and networking. Like how well can you make the hang after the gig and get to know other people? If you're like a super amazing player but you're a terrible person, you might be able to squeak by if those other two ones are high enough up. Right. Mm-hmm. So you might be able to show up drunk to a gig, but if you play your butt off the next 100 gigs, like maybe people will forgive you that because you're also really good at networking. You're also a really friendly person. And you can have a person that's like a mediocre player, really, but is an amazing person to hang out with and always shows up on time and is really good at networking. That happens too.
And they're very successful.
And they're very successful. Yeah, totally.